Good afternoon, ladies and gentlemen, and welcome to the final press conference following the March European Council. Without further ado, I first invite the President of the European Council, Donald Tusk, to take the floor. Please, sir.
Thank you, Preben, Jean-Claude. Good afternoon. Today, leaders discussed how to best prepare the EU for increasing global economic competition. This means strengthening the European single market and industrial base, which is key for job creation. We also agreed on the need for an open and assertive trade policy. In this context, the European Council called to resume the discussion on the public procurement instrument. We want to reinforce European capacity to deal with technology, theft, and cybersecurity threats, and we look forward to the Commission's recommendation on the security of 5G networks. We also discussed the priorities for next month's summit with China. Our aim is to focus on achieving a balanced relation which ensures fair competition and equal market access. In this context, we hope to persuade China to include industrial subsidies as a crucial element of the WTO reform. Additionally, leaders were univocal in their determination to tackle climate change with urgency and ambition. Our ministers will intensify work on the EU's climate strategy to implement the goals set down by the Paris Agreement. We will come back to this issue in June. As regards Brexit, the European Council formalized last night's decisions by the EU27 and the UK to delay the cleavage and allow for an extension. Personally, I'm really happy about this development. As I said yesterday, it means that until the 12th of April, anything is possible. A deal, a long extension, if the UK decided to rethink its strategy, or revoking Article 50, which is a prerogative of the UK government. The fate of Brexit is in the hands of our British friends. We are, as the EU, we are prepared for the worst, but hope for the best. As you know, hope dies last. Thank you.
Thank you. And now President Juncker of the European Commission.
Oui, Monsieur le Président, mes chers amis, nous n'avons pas
thank you
seulement
very
parlé du
much.
Royaume-Uni,
Well,
mais aussi de la
President,
Chine.
My dear friends, we didn't just talk about the United Kingdom, we talked about China as well. It was much more easy to talk about China than it was to talk about the United Kingdom, I have to say. Not that China is asking to join the European Union, but it's because it's not leaving the European Union.
Des relations, oui, comment dire, bonnes.
Our relations with China are, yes, well, how shall I put it, they're good relations, not excellent. China is a competitor, a partner,
a rival.
Et donc
il faut s'ajouter à cette nouvelle donne de la vie internationale. Il y a, pour ce qui est du commerce entre la Chine et l'Europe, une asymétrie. Et des asymétries créent des déséquilibres. Et on ne peut pas construire quelque chose de stable
we can't create
sur
something
base
stable on the basis of something that continues to be imbalanced. We don't have the reciprocity that we need in our trade relations with China. And competition between China and the European Union is not fair.
Avec la Chine, un
which is why
sur les investissements.
We want to conclude an agreement on investments with China.
Depuis un certain moment,
this is something
dont
that we've been discussing for some time.
Non, cette semaine, je crois,
I believe
avec le ministre des Affaires
this
étrangères
week,
chinoise, que,
I, was,
que
I discussed this with
the
Ministry of
Paris,
Foreign Affairs in China,
Macron
and I will be discussing this on Tuesday morning
chinois,
next week. President in Paris, President
Macron
has invited China, there will be
General
Angela Merkel as well, and I think that this will be a way of preparing for the summit with China.
Les marchés chinois sont insuffisamment ouverts
aux produits européens.
Les marchés publics chinois nous laissent largement exclus, alors qu'il serait important que, comme la Chine peut participer au marché public en Europe,
is able to take part in public procurement in Europe. It would be good if Europe could do the same in China. And this is not
un montant de 2400 milliards. Et ces 2400 milliards sont intégralement ou presque accessibles aux entreprises étrangères. Alors qu'il faut à la vérité de dire que sur les 8 000 milliards d'euros que représentent sur un plan global les marchés publics, l'Europe n'en bénéficie qu'à hauteur de 10 milliards d'euros, donc il y a du travail à faire. Raison pour laquelle la Commission en 2016
it only has access to 10 billion. So there's a lot of work to be done, which means that there was an initial proposal in 2012, and then a proposal was made for international procurement. I talked about this with heads of state and government this morning. Something else that's very important is a new framework for investment screening. This is a very important instrument.
Une économie offerte, mais bien sûr une économie ouverte qui exige de ses partenaires de connaître les mêmes règles et les mêmes principes. Lorsque nous présentons sur d'autres marchés, que trouvent sur le chemin ceux qui se présentent sur nos marchés. Si nous avions déjà eu ce mécanisme de screening qui entre en vigueur, je crois, le 1er avril de cette année, ce mécanisme nous aurait permis de couvrir 83% des investissements directs.
Could have covered 83% of Chinese foreign direct investment in 2018. So this is a major issue. Now I can see that you're impressed, but I suppose that you won't be for long.
Okay, thank you. I open the floor for questions. I think Christian was the first. Please, sir.
Oui. Bonjour, Christian Spielmann de l'AFP. Vous avez parlé tout à l'heure de la sécurité sur la 5G. Vous allez rencontrer les Chinois il n'y a pas longtemps, dans quelques temps. Je voudrais savoir s'il faut bannir le groupe Huawei des marchés de la télécom et de la 5G en Europe, ou si vous n'avez pas du tout les mêmes visions que les États-Unis et l'OTAN. Et si vous me permettez une deuxième petite question annexe, est-ce que c'est sérieux de parler des informations comme ça sur la fin d'un sommet alors que le sujet est très très important? Est-ce que c'est pas un peu regrettable d'avoir eu aussi peu de temps pour parler d'un sujet qui intéresse tous les Européens?
Why did you take so little to discuss an issue like this that's so important to citizens?
Dear friend, disinformation.
Curieusement, je n'ai pas mentionné aujourd'hui.
Is in the process of drawing up a communication which will be submitted for your perusal
in 15 days.
Thank you. And the next question goes to the gentleman here in the first row, in the middle, Mark.
It's always the same, huh? How is that possible?
Thank you.
Go ahead.
No, I have never met him.
He's unknown in this room.
We've met. Gentlemen, Mark Stone from Sky News. You seemed, and you still seem, in fact, almost giddy at the result that you came up with last night on Brexit. But essentially, you have simply kicked the can down the road again. Given the pattern that we see from Westminster, are the chances not just still just as high of being on the eve of no deal on the 11th of April? And a second question, if I may, you've celebrated the 25th anniversary of the European Economic Area today. Do you expect you'll celebrate the 26th birthday with the UK present?
The road the Cannon has in perspective is a very short one.
Yeah, I think we are not the best address for this question. You know, we were, and we will be also really determined to achieve the best possible deal. But almost everything is now in the hands of the British Parliament and Theresa May's government.
You'd like the UK to be there?
I think that you know my position. I am more pro-British than you, I think. Thank
you. And the next question goes to the lady on our right, Gabriela.
Thank you, Gabriela Baczynska, Reuters. Sorry to be asking you a question about an issue that was not directly on your agenda, but the world doesn't stop when EU summits take place. It's about Golan Heights and US President Donald Trump's declaration that he wants to recognize the sovereignty of Israel over the territory. It looks like it's a statement that would mark a sharp change of policy from the US on this delicate issue and in the middle of a political campaign in Israel. So where does the EU stand, and does it change the EU's position in any way? Thank you.
We didn't discuss this today, but because the EU's position is well known and has not changed. This is why it wasn't a topic for our today's discussion.
I think that Mrs. Mogherini has issued a statement related to this Golan issue. You can refer to that.
That's great. And then a very last question. I think, David, I had you. Gentleman here in the middle.
Thanks, David Herzenhorn with Politico. I was struck by your, for both presidents, by your comparison to the discussions about China and the discussions about the UK, both potential partners but also potential rivals in the future. And I wonder if you could talk to us a little about, is the EU tough enough to handle these rivalries, or put another way, does China respect investment screening or naval ships in the South China Sea?
It's maybe more for Jean-Claude. I'm mentally not able to treat today equally the UK and China. You know, it's and for me, the UK is still a member of our family, not a rival.
By the way, I didn't compare China to Britain, but I'm admiring your sense of humor.